Welcome to episode 42 of the Michael Lab Show. Thank you so much for being here with me on this fine day. Thank you so much for just sticking it out with this podcast and tuning in every week and watching it and showing it love. And, you know, I can go over, I can ramble on, but I'm not going to. I get so many positive messages of people saying, you know, I can see the progress. And there's something about that that resonates so much with me that I need to hear. Honestly, like, you know, you don't want to sound needy ever, but there are times in your life where you need, like, an affirmation. You can only give yourself so many affirmations, and you can only develop so many affirmations. And an affirmation is essentially something that you say to yourself every day, hopefully every day, at least one time every 2 days. This is very risky business. My drinks. Last episode, I didn't have a cold drink. I didn't have a hot drink. I didn't have a drink, man. I didn't have anything to, you know, quench my thirst there. Because your mouth gets really dry, especially when you drink coffee. And I drank coffee before that podcast. So my mouth is just very, very parched. So it was harder to talk. And also, these allow you to transition. So I can say this. Start talking about giraffes. Gives kind of your brain a break. And you can move on. It's kind of like a transition of a chapter of a book. You end the book. You end the chapter with the period. You got a blank page. Boom, another chapter coming your way. But, yeah, sometimes I need, like, affirmations. An affirmation is something that you tell yourself when you get down. Or just to remind yourself. It's like a self-talk mechanism, a technique that allows you to remind yourself what makes you a positive person. You know, life can really just keep on. Life is really good at showing you your flaws instead of promoting your positive side, your positive characteristics. So with the affirmation, it forces you every day to point out at least something that's going on that's good about you. But I get people often, at least once a day, saying the podcast is coming along, keep pushing content. And sometimes it's hard. You know, sometimes it's hard, not like talking, not like subject matter, but the hardest part at times is you lose almost like a, not a drive, but it can almost feel stale, as in like the growth, not doing it, like sitting down doing it, this is an issue, but like uploading it and then watching it grow, you know, you almost, you got to learn to kind of live in the trenches and it's so weird because it's growing, you know, it's growing every week. And it's hard for me to recognize that because I'm the one who's in the trenches. But when audience members, I don't like that word, but when people tell me that it's getting better and better, no matter what that level or whatever that judgment of better is, whether it be the quality, whether it be the subject matter, whether it be the setting or just the overall feeling of it, whatever that is, that's beautiful. And it helps me and it reminds me of why I started and what the purpose is. And, you know, nobody, you don't ever want to stall out in life, especially when you're doing something that is like this, you know, you want to keep progressing. So, thank you so much for everybody who has been really, really helping me out on that. A few things that I have been doing that's helped me, this episode and last episode, I've started implementing this book right here. It's just like a little journal that my girl got me, and it allows me to like stay on track and have like certain subject matter that I want to cover. And the cause for that is it gives me bullet points to come back to when I get lost in the episode. Sometimes you go into topics and you talk about them. And like I used to just go into a podcast with no structure. And you could tell a lot of like rambling. And I'm the first to admit it, a lot of rambling and like, so what's going on? What's going on? What's going on? You know, like a comedian up on stage or like an actor who forgot their lines and they just kind of role play. But, you know, sometimes the role play isn't good. So I've been kind of, I've been trying to have like some sort of structure. But yeah, I hope everyone's having a great day. I hope everyone's doing super well. I think this podcast is going to be up Friday. I'm not 100% sure. But I was watching football this past weekend, and there's a couple upsets. There was the Browns beat the Bills. the Falcons, I think, like, crushed the Saints. And the Packers almost lost, and I'm a Packers fan. That's who I enjoy. Every time I talk about sports on this podcast, I almost feel like it's not, like, people don't want to hear it. Like, I feel like there's no depth to it, but it's kind of something I just want to speak on real quick. So the NFL recently, within the past, like, I would say 2 years, has finally been on, like, a positive slope. Before that, the NFL was kind of, like, taking a downfall for, like, the worst when it came to, like, overall revenue. Or not, like, revenue. They're still making a shit ton of money. But, like, viewership. And people kind of stopped watching the NFL for a few reasons. Like, a lot of botched cases with players when it comes to, like, violations of certain things. You have players who smoke a little weed and are getting suspended for, like, years. And then you have a player who's beating the shit out of the girlfriend and they're back in like a year and a half. So the NFL's kind of really been struggling to protect their ethics and really what they're about. So it's forced a lot of fans to, like, I know personally from my father, he's definitely been one of those fans who's like, I'm not watching the NFL. I mean, this was like 4 or 5 years ago. He wouldn't watch the NFL. And, I was like really confused by it. I didn't really care. But, you know, ethically, if it doesn't line up with what you believe in, and what was going on with the NFL, it's like, I don't want to support this, you know? And so they were, like, struggling with that. And then, like, the whole concussion thing, which is still going on, and how they weren't, like, paying their ex-football players for head injuries. Even, and, like, they were, like, denying that a lot of players were developing, ETC, EKGs, what's it called? Fuck. What's it called? A brain injury. Damn it, I'm not gonna remember it. Anyways, they were developing that the brain. If you guys remember, please like drop it below. I'll probably remember it halfway during the podcast and shoot it out of my mouth like a fucking like out of nowhere. Not epilepsy. Anyways, they were developing a lot of brain injuries and the players were suing and basically you owe us like. You got to give us credit for, like, you got to help us out financially for this because we can't afford everything because we weren't making as much money when we played and you guys are a billion-dollar organization and you're not helping us out at all. So what you saw is a lot of people who their ethics didn't line up with that or they kind of saw that as fucked up like I did. They weren't watching the NFL anymore and the Patriots were winning so much so the competition was at a minimal too. But now you're in 2019 and you have the NFL is back on the rise. You know, it's like they started taking responsibility for things. They kind of started actually dishing out correct penalties for certain players. Even though they're still struggling with that a lot at, you know, often. But it's definitely a lot less, it's a lot more understandable as a fan now. It makes more sense, you know, it makes more sense. And they're finally starting to give back to the players who are struggling because of dramatic brain injuries, TBI, that's what it's called. That's like a, it's also called something else too. But anyway, so the NFL has 32 owners. You know, some of them are owned by like the team, like the fans themselves, like the Packers. I think that's the only one. And then some of them are owned by like single people, like a person. Like Jerry Jones for the Cowboys, Dan Snyder for the Redskins, Arthur Blank for the Falcons. Who's the sexual toucher? Peter Kraft, Robert Kraft, the guy who was inside of the like stuff like that. Like that shit's weird. Like you hear about this story of like this owner going into a massage parlor and like getting charged, and then like nothing happens to him. Like it's stuff like that. Like it's almost like the Jerry Epstein thing. Like everyone's talking about it and then it just goes away. And then when we hear about the facts, it still like doesn't boil back up. We're like, what the fuck is going on? People don't like that. People want to be in the know, obviously, for like real reasons. Like those are real issues. But the NFL is finally back on the upswing. I think a lot of it has to do with there's other competitors in the NFL. It looks like the Baltimore Ravens are like the top team. Like they beat the Patriots. There's now the Falcons. Crush the Saints, who I thought were going to go to the Super Bowl. You got the Packers. You have, there's just so many teams that could potentially, the Bills, the 49ers are still undefeated. So there's like so many teams now. And I think that allows the fan bases of those teams to feel hope. So therefore, they're going to be watching more, telling their friends about them, and there's just more of a competitive edge. Like, you want to watch that. Like, when Tiger Woods was at his top of his game, Tiger Woods was at the top of his game, you didn't watch it as much because there's like a 20% chance he's going to win every time he goes out. Even the NBA is like that too. The NBA is very much like that right now. The NBA has a lot of different teams. Like, it's not just Team LeBron that's going to go all the way, which is, I think, is great for the NBA. I don't really watch the NBA, but like, even the Wizards, like my local team, they have a chance to possibly go all the way too. So competition brings higher viewership. But what I saw, so I was just looking through the news yesterday, and the CEO of Amazon, his name is Jeff Bezos. He, hopefully by the time this podcast comes out, I'm not, like, it didn't already happen. But so he's the CEO of Amazon. He owns Amazon, which owns, like, Whole Foods. Amazon owns so much shit. They're the leader in shipping. They also basically not own, but they are highly, a lot of small businesses highly rely and highly, quote unquote, are invested into Amazon for their businesses. So you have Amazon, which is the biggest global company when it comes. And then you have like Alibaba, who's up there, which is a Chinese company, which I actually used for a while to get clothing and stuff like that. But you have all these huge, these huge global companies. And the biggest one, you have Amazon, which is a $1 trillion company. And then you have, I think so. And then you have, well, they're going to be anyways. And then you have like Apple. Then you have Google. You know, pretty much those are the three competitors. You have like an Alibaba. You have a Huawei phone out in China. Alibaba, which is like the B2B. So it's like the business to business Amazon. Whereas like Amazon's like a B2C, so business to customer, but it's also business to business, because if you use Amazon for like your small business, like I could have done, you ship a certain amount of product to Amazon and they take care of all the shipping, all the fulfillment for you, which for someone like me, I wasn't too worried about. I just bought a printer and I did the thing. But for some people, it can save so much time and it's worth it. It wasn't worth it to me because I couldn't afford it. But I don't think the price is that high because they have so many customers. Anyways, I digress. But Amazon is a huge company. You guys use them all the time. I use them all the time, and they're very efficient, and Jeff Bezos is the mastermind behind it. He is he was a summa cum laude of Princeton, which is, like, the highest GPA in Princeton, so he's not just, like, street smart, like people like to say, but he's smart in every aspect. Like, he's got it all, and you see, like, his eye, like, twitch out every once in a while. You're like, fuck, he's a robot, too. Not really, but he does kind of, like, have, like, a robotic feel to him. I'm waiting for him to get on Joe Rogan, and I'm waiting for Donald Trump to get on Joe Rogan. Like, I didn't think he was going to get Elon Musk on. There's a strong possibility that he will get Amazon, Jeff Bezos on. That would be insane. And we're still waiting for Kanye, Joe. Amazon is looking to get into the football game, which is absolutely insane to me. So he's looking at a few teams. I think it was the Seahawks, the Broncos, and the Redskins. Now, I'm not going to talk about the Seattle Seahawks. Obviously, that's like a technology advanced company. I think his company's based out. I think Amazon's based out of Seattle, I want to say. Out of Portland. I want to say the headquarters of Amazon is based out of Seattle. So we're going to go with Seattle. But his DC, dude, guys, I'm so happy with this podcast. You guys are beautiful people. Thank you so much. I'm so random, but I truly am appreciative of everybody who supports this podcast. But DC, this is the very, very interesting one. So DC is the capital of the country, which is the strongest country in the world. So it's got so much power. Jeff Bezos has a $500 million deal with the Pentagon. Edward Snowden talked about it on his podcast, how Amazon has a huge, huge, huge impact on whatever the government does. They share data, at least Google does, but I'm pretty sure like Amazon shares data. Dude, I don't know. I fact check these definitely. But that's all from Edward Snowden. But what's really interesting is Jeff Bezos has been looking to buy a house or build a house in Washington, D.C. I think more particular, it was in Bethesda, Maryland, which is where my girlfriend's father, I think he works around that area. Bethesda, Maryland is like the most popular, or like one of the highest financially, one of the richest cities in the world, or at least in the country, maybe not the world. Montgomery County, Prince George's County, Anne Arundel County, all these counties right around D.C. are so rich. And now you have the Washington Redskins. So you have this guy, Jeff Bezos, who owns the biggest world company, who is probably the most powerful person in the world. Like step aside, Donald Trump, you know what I mean? Like, money is king, right? So money is king, and he is the king of the money. You know, he is the king of the businesses. He has a strong hold on to small businesses, which are the backbone of the country, right? Small businesses are the backbone of the country. Okay, well, what if that backbone of the country is on the backbone of the biggest country, the biggest company in the world? The backbone of the country, small businesses, are on the backbone of the biggest business, Amazon. So you have that going on, and then you have him living in D.C., and then you have him looking to – he was looking to build a Amazon warehouse in D.C. I think they decided to go to New York, but I think that might still be up for debate. And then you have him looking – I think he sat down with Dan Snyder, who's the current CEO and owner of the Washington Redskins. So you have Jeff Bezos looking to buy a football team. And you got to remember, this guy's worth $100 billion. I would say hundreds of billions of dollars. I think there's only a few people richer than him, and they're probably like Saudi Arabian prince, you know, like all those people out there, like the oil magnates. But we don't really know their net worth. But then again, we don't really know Jeff Bezos' net worth because of everything that his money's in. He's like not in it for like a year. He's in it for like 30 years. Like he's in it for the takeover. And he also owns spaceships through Blue Origin. But you have this going on. And I just thought this was so interesting. Like, this is what's so interesting about, I love business and I love these huge business transactions. And like, if Dan Snyder sells the Washington Redskins to Jeff Bezos and Amazon, that is like, it's so strange to me because NFL has always, to me, seemed like a place for like, it's always been commercial, but it just never seemed like, I don't know. I don't want to say mainstream because it's always been mainstream, but I just feel like I don't know what it is, but I can't really connect it in my head. But like the NFL and Amazon just doesn't seem like they should go together, at least ownership wise. But I think you can watch like football games on Amazon Video. But it's just crazy to me to think, what will Jeff Bezos do to the Redskins? Like, what would the stadium look like? What would the players be wearing? What will the seats be like? What will the services be like at the stadium? Because this is the guy who's literally flying just drones to ship packages. You know, it's just it's like the beginning. Honestly, when I saw this on Twitter, I was like, this is the beginning of a new era. You know what I mean? This is the beginning of a new era with Amazon, which is the largest internet company, owning a football team of the biggest sport, second biggest sport in the world behind soccer or football. It's just so, I don't know, it's so mind-boggling to me and like see these multi-billion dollar deals go down between gentlemen who are so rich. I don't know. I don't know. But I thought that was really interesting, and I went on that a little bit longer than I wanted to, but you know, I'm going to get off the NFL. I want to talk about something that I was reading in my book yesterday. I'm reading this book right now called the 4 billion life, the 4 billion years of ourself, how we developed our conscious minds, by Joseph Deloux, D-E-L-O-U-X, I think his name is, and I got a lot of reading done yesterday, or whenever you watch, whatever, Sunday, and this book is super good. It starts off with the ancestors, so the beginning of time, and like basically how we became bipedal hominoids, and how we like different advantages that we have, and everything that we developed was because of this and this and this, and it talks about the history of evolution, like basically how humans became bipedal, and how there's certain things, like listen to this, this is so interesting. So all humans came from, I want to say it was like fish. I don't want to sound like an idiot, but I think so. I think like all animals came, obviously we all came from fish because there's no land animals before. There was fish that turned into like land water animals, which slowly became into mammals, which developed into, you know, things that allowed us to become humans. I sound like an idiot. I'm not a scientist, not a researcher. I just remember things and I spit them out of my face. But it's an incredible book and I highly recommend it to everybody out there. At least open your mind up to things and just like, even if you don't believe in evolution, I think it's really interesting to at least like draw connections and notice that, oh wait, maybe we do share this characteristic with this animal, with this gorilla, whatever it is. But it can get a little depressing once you start thinking about like the whole purpose of this life is just to reproduce and die. And then, yeah, that can get a little depressing. This book is super interesting. He brings up, I'm finally like in the part of the book where it's like the introduction is gone. Since I've been reading so many books lately, I've slowly been starting to realize, like, what is the introduction? Like, what is the point of this book? And he's talking a lot about consciousness and unconsciousness and the difference between both of those. And how, like, anthropomorphisms, like, giving animals human-like characteristics and stuff like that. And he quotes this gentleman, this philosopher, and I just kind of want to read the quote, and I want to talk about it for a little bit, and I don't know where that's going to take me, but I just want to talk about it real quick. His name is Rene Descartes. I think he was a French philosopher, and I think he was a philosopher who was, I completely forget, and I don't hold my phone. I don't like to have my laptop and electric around me. I like another reason I love doing this podcast so much is because, dude, it's like a whole hour of no technology. And it sounds dumb, but not having any technology on you is like it's like taking your brain, putting in a quarter and like restarting it. Or that's a terrible example. It's like, yeah, it's like just putting your brain and injecting it with like melatonin, telling it to go to bed while you're still talking. Like it just slows down my thinking and it slows down my mindless thinking, my useless thinking, the stuff that has no purpose, but it allows me to actually have critical thinking, logistical thinking, and ability to like problem solve. It like opens up, like when I have like phones and computers in front of me, it like closes off those doors and I like lose the keys. But then when I kind of put those tools away, I put those devices away. The doors don't open, but I find the key and I can at least open the door. And I really like that about the podcast a lot. Actually, it's kind of something I don't really talk about too much, but I do love it. oh yeah, and one other change is that in the description on YouTube now, I'm gonna put like what the podcast is gonna be about. I finally decided to just make that change. Now since I write down like a lot of my topics, I think it's gonna help a lot. It's gonna allow me to, I guess, present you guys with something you want to watch in a certain topics. You guys can like skim through the video and like stop at certain topics if you want to. One other thing, if there's anybody out there who would want to, you don't have to, or if you know anybody who would want to help me with, I'm thinking about doing like clips of the videos. So like a clip channel. I don't know if I want to do a clip channel, but if I want to do like just a clips between uploads, where I take like certain clips of, we can go back to episode 1, where I talk about a topic for, you know, lengthy, so like 5 to 15, 20 minutes, and I upload those as a separate video. If anybody out there would be willing to do that, please contact me. We could set something up. I will promote you, and if you're willing to do that, that would help me so much. I just can't do it right now. Like I guess I could, but I'm not valuing it enough to like say fuck homework. Like I could squeeze it in. I kind of do it like on Instagram TV, on my main Instagram, Mike R Labs. But I think it would help me a lot, and I think it could help you guys a lot. Just get some experience with podcasting. If that's something that you want to do, if it is, just please contact me. You can DM me on Instagram, or you can email me at Michael Labs R as in Robert at gmail.com, MICHAELLABSR at gmail.com. So if you guys want to do that, that would help me out a lot, and I think it can help out the channel a lot and help out the podcast a lot too. So this book quotes a gentleman by the name of Rene Descartes, who's a French philosopher, and I really like the quote. It talks about struggles and difficult and how to manage your energy, your bandwidth on certain things, and how to. Anyways, I'm just going to read it real quick. So it's Rene Descartes, it's a French philosopher, says, quote, divide each difficulty into as many parts as it is feasible and necessary to resolve it. Divide each difficulty into as many parts as is feasible and necessary to resolve it. So I read that quote, and it's so, you know, it's, you can say it's a silly quote, but I read it and it made so much sense to me. Like, it made so much sense to me that I actually reached over and I grabbed a piece of paper. I'm acting like reaching over is like a huge, huge deal. But I grabbed a piece of paper and I wrote it down because I wanted to talk about it. I wanted to really talk it through. Because it's so, it makes so much sense. You know, it makes so much sense. And the way it translated in my head is life will present you with so many hardships at a rapid fire pace. And we are expected to resolve them or at least deal with them up to a point where we can function healthily, helpfully in this world. And we're taught so much to kind of burden stuff, keep it moving, you know, put down your shoulder and just keep chugging along. And this quote kind of goes against that. It says, no, don't do that. There's going to be hardships. Yes, there's going to be hardships. There's going to be difficulties. Just like everybody. Everyone experiences them different ways and different situations, but we all experience them, right? And the way that I took this quote is when you are in thought and you're by yourself and you can really think about everything that's going on, you could take a number line, stretch out this number line and put down good things on it. But then in between the good things or like a long stretch of the number line, it's filled up with bad things. Instead of trying to burden that bad thing and treating it as one bucket, you have a 5-gallon bucket, take out the water and stretch it across cups, little tiny 8-ounce cups, you know, throughout this timeline. So you have this one difficult issue, which is, yes, it's a big issue. But why is it a big issue? It's a big issue because the ingredients that made it a big issue are all little micro difficult situations. You know, you have a blow up with your significant other, or you have a huge argument with your boss, or something happens, you know, or you fail a test. That's a difficult situation that presents you with a hard thing to get over, and the ramifications of it are so great. But if you can take a step back before this happens, and you notice that there is this big overarching difficult situation, and you can kind of pour the water out and see all the little things that led to it. Now, why did you have this huge argument with your significant other? Is it because that subject that you guys talked about was everything? That argument that you had, 98% of it was because of that moment you talked, in the moment that they said something and it blew up. Or, is it because it's been going on for weeks? There's been micro attacks. There's been passive aggressiveness. Maybe you haven't been getting the looks that you wanted at colleges. Maybe you haven't been getting the love that you expect from work. Maybe you haven't been able to sleep. You know, maybe you haven't been able to sleep and you kind of been rolling around. Or maybe you feel like you and your significant other haven't been talking as much. And all these little events lead up to this one boiling point. The water's high, you know, the heat's turned up, and it's getting ready to overflow. And then you have a little thing that just lights the match, you know, and it blows up. It's because you walked in and they didn't say hi to you from work, you know. obviously these aren't me because I don't do that. We don't live together, but you're presented with all these micro issues all day. You know, these things that do chip away at you, that do make you feel mentally and emotionally exhausted. You know, but they're not big enough to really make you take time out of your day to resolve them. So you never resolve them. There's just a bunch of open pots everywhere with water boiling, you know, and then it goes in the big pot, and then it blows up. And that's what this quote was. So this is, it hit me so hard. It's to divide each difficulty into as many parts as is feasible and necessary to resolve it. Necessary to resolve it. If it doesn't need your attention, and if the solution is easy, the solution is obvious, there's no reason to dig deeper and dig deeper and dig deeper. Because that energy you're presented with every day, you're presented with 100 points of energy each day, you know? And if there's a little issue and you've resolved it, there's no reason to keep bearing at the issue. You know, there's no reason to keep poking at it. Just be okay with it. You know, be okay with it being resolved. Maybe not the best way, but it's resolved, you know? People are at an understanding. And you can tell. And you may ask, well, Michael, that doesn't make sense. Don't you want to resolve it 100%? Yes, you do. But also you got to understand, if you fight on that thing all day, there's other issues, that other difficult situations that are going to pop up throughout the day. You know, if all your energy is spent on that one thing, then those other situations are going to find a way to just creep back in your life later. And it's all about that. It's all about dividing your attention span to certain things and trying to resolve them and trying to figure out how to find an answer that will be understood on from each person, that figures out a solution and that will allow for that boiling point not to exist. And then feasible. Like, that's what I was saying. If it's feasible, you know, sometimes things seem like they're out of control, but they're really not. And you got to look at a lot. There's a lot of self-reflection that comes with this part. You got to look at yourself, be like, okay, well, you know what? Wait a second here. Why am I actually mad because when I walked in the door, she didn't say hi to me? Come on. Like, let me think about this. Oh, it's because I've been having a bad day at work. You know, if I was having a good day at work, she didn't say hi to me, I wouldn't be mad. I wouldn't be upset because I had a good day at work, you know, but since I had a fucked up day at work, I feel like she has to say hi to me. Now that issue, whose issue is that now? Whose issue is that? Is that yours or hers? That's yours. It's called communication. You got to communicate. You got to make it feasible to have a solution. But if you go into it already looking for a battle, dude, it's not going to get anywhere. I love that quote. Divide each difficulty into as many parts as is feasible and necessary to resolve it. Because that is how you resolve things. When people say things got too out of hand, you know, you see it all the time. You probably did it. I know I did it as a child. You get stuck in a lie. You know, you get stuck in a lie, and then there was this one person, middle school, or maybe it's probably elementary school. No, it's probably middle school. And I told people that I kissed this girl when I didn't. I didn't. I never did. But I said it so much that, and I wanted to. Like, in my head, I was like, oh, yeah, cool. Would have been like my first kiss ever. But I never did, you know? And then I got caught on the bus. And it was so weird because I knew it didn't happen. But in my head, I built it up so much so that it did happen. You know, and then when the water came boiling out of the pot, I felt like, damn, I could have resolved it from the beginning. I could have stopped myself. I could have, like, why was I even lying? Like, what are you so insecure about? I might have been a bad example of it, but you know what I mean. You get the point. Did I just sound like a dolphin right there? Maybe not. I love dolphins. But yeah, there's just so many times in life where you have this blow up moment. But you have this blow-up moment because all this water under the bridge. Like, don't do that. Don't let the water go under the bridge. Break down issues. Break down your day into little micro situations and resolve them as they go, as they come, and as they go. You know, you got to do that. Just like in school, you're not going to pass a class at 20%, or you're not going to get a A in the class of 20% of your grades, homework. Homework is divided throughout the semester. If you're only going to take the test, you get 100% on everything. You can only get an 80 in the class. You know, and then you're going to complain about your GPA. Why is your GPA that low? Why did you get a 3.0 instead of a 4.0? I did all the tests. I did super well. And then, well, did you not do all these homeworks? You created little micro issues that led to a big issue at the end, a lower GPA. I love that quote. I love it. It really did help me a lot. It made me stop for a second and kind of just reminisce about everything. And it almost reinforced everything that I already think, because I have been thinking this way for a good bit now. I think long enough that I can't talk about it. When I see things come up, I kind of collect myself. And I really pause and I say, wait a second. Who am I mad at? And why am I angry? I didn't sleep well. Maybe that's it. Maybe that's why I'm a little bit more outspoken, I guess, or a lot more looking for an argument, I guess, in some ways. I get that way. But I don't know. I really love that quote. I can never sit with my left foot underneath my right leg. I can always do it with my right leg underneath my... I can never put my left foot underneath my right leg, but I can put my right foot underneath my left leg so easily. It feels comfortable when I put my right foot underneath my left leg, but I think the issue is I'm starting to develop like a really bad hip imbalance because of that. I'm thinking about getting a new chair too, but... Yeah, so I'm gonna end up on one more topic. I'm probably going to end the podcast with this topic right here. It's going to be a little bit longer, I think. But as you guys know, Veterans Day was this past week. And Veterans Day to me is a huge holiday. Not like personal, like within my life. But it's a huge holiday because I find that I have a lot of family that is military or CIA, but especially military. And one person that I never really talk about enough, I always talk about his wife, but my grandpa, I don't talk about him because I don't really know what to talk about him about, because I never met the dude. I never met him. The only thing I know of him is some stories that my mom told me. I do know his dad was from Ireland. I know my grandpa Jack grew up kind of boxing. I knew he was a shorter guy. I knew he was a spitfire, a ball out of a cannon, and I knew he didn't take shit. And I knew he smoked a pack a day. I knew he drank, and I know he was a great father when he could be. And I know he loved my grandmother, because my grandmother, in her conscious state and in her semi-lucid state, she talked about Grandpa Jack. She always says something to me. Everyone always says this to me. Family, they always say Grandpa Jack would have loved you, you know, and that means so much to me. And I bottle that up inside. I'm like, what does that mean? And then I kind of form everything I know about him into this person. I've talked about it before in the podcast where I'm like, I feel like I met him. Like, I'd lied to people before, like, I sat on his lap. Like, here's a picture of me and him, but it was like a picture of me and my great uncle, like my dad's uncle or something. And he had that impact on me, and it was from a dude who was never even alive. But the reason why I say Happy Veterans Day is because this guy was a veteran. You know, he was in the military. He was in the military. He fought during World War II. And I have this really cool picture on my phone. I'll pull it up real quick. I don't know if I'll be able to show it to you guys. I don't know if you guys can see this. Maybe if you... like pause right now, you can see that picture. But it's a picture of my grandpa during World War II underneath the Eiffel Tower. You know, and the World War II has always been so historic. You know, it's been history. When you think about it, you don't think about it as like yesterday, even though it basically was. You know, it wasn't that long ago. What, 70, 80 years ago, 90 years ago? 80, 90 years ago, 1930-something it ended, 1940-something. I'm so bad with history. I don't know. 70 to 90 years ago, that's embarrassing. Yeah, because World War I was 1918. I think so. Right, 1918? I think it 1916 to 1918, World War I was. But yeah, I see that picture and it brought everything into like perspective, you know? And then I have cousins like, I don't want to say their names, but I have cousins that are in the war, you know? And I work with, I mean, everyone I work with is in the military. Most people, you know, at least ties to the military. Like my manager was in the military. He was a Marine. And it's one of those holidays that I really do enjoy. And I think it's so important for us to understand that every day we wake up, I was telling my manager this, you know, we live in a safe country because you never have to think about getting up and dying. You know, that's powerful, right? Because there's countries out there where you wake up and you go to bed and you're like, fuck, I made it to bed. Thank God. And you still have a fear of not making it through the night. For the majority of people that live in this country, you can go to bed and you will wake up at night. It's so secure in this country that we make plans. Yeah, we're going to have dinner on Thanksgiving here. Like we made these future plans. Like our safety is so taken for granted. It's so not even thought about by the common person. And the reason why I think about it is because my parents were police officers. And they really instilled that thought in me. Like, you better be thankful for everything you have. Because everything you have is not just there because people are good. It's there because people, like those veterans and current people deployed, are out there risking their life to keep us in a safe world. Where our only issues are fellow Americans killing fellow Americans. Not bombs being dropped on us. Not our own government poisoning us, you know? We can play these stupid circus games. He said, she said, did you hear the president say this? Did you hear what she said to him? We can play these stupid, shallow, meaningless, pointless, almost drama-induced, no density issues. Like breaking news, Drake got booed off his stage. Like we can have these things. We can have all these stupid, dumb issues, like these middle school drama things, because our safety is never impeded on. Not for the common American. You know, not for the common American. And it's because of our veterans. And I don't want to get too patriotic in here. Oh, I will, though, because I don't care. But it's because of those people. It's because of my grandpa. It's because of my manager. It's because of my cousins, you know? It's because of your brother, your sister, if you're listening to this, your cousins, you know, your best friend. As a collective group, they allow us to go to bed knowing that I can wake up and go to a job. That I can sit back and say, oh, I hate my job. You have income coming in, you know? And you're not afraid of your building getting bombed like happens in the Middle East, you know? And I think we just all need to take a second out of our days. And I know Veteran Day is already passed by the time you heard this podcast, but I think we can't take those things for granted, because the moment we do, the moment we get comfortable and things slip up, and we got to thank a veteran. We got to thank a first responder. We have to not ever stop pushing for things to get better, but never ever act like they don't do anything for us. Don't ever act like the cops aren't the prime majority of cops. The overwhelming 99.9% of cops out there are there to protect you. First responders are there to save you. Military is there to protect the country. You know, and yes, there might be some military people that are there to just kill people. And, you know, there might be men just with all this built up whatever. Anger, a rough childhood, and they just want to let off steam. You know, there might be that. But guess what a byproduct of that is? Just like a tree when it's growing and it's producing energy for itself, a byproduct of that is they're sucking CO2 out of the air and giving us oxygen to breathe. You see what I mean? A byproduct of those people, those men and women going into the war is we are waking up every day knowing that our day is going to continue. And that is something that we can't take for granted. That's something that when you see a veteran, you can't act like they're not helping you, you know? And I really did. I want to talk about that. You got to live You got to live in gratefulness for those people. You have to. And I hate, and I don't like people who are anti-military. It's like, cool, be anti-military. I get it. Be anti-military. You don't like the idea of people killing each other and you want peace. But guess what? Until there's peace, there's going to be a military. That might be counterintuitive. And you say, well, there's got to be no military if we want peace. But guess what? There may not be peace. Do you want peace? Do you really want peace? Think about that. Would you want peace? There's been many times, many examples. You see it in nature. Peace is not good. Not good. You don't want that. You don't want a world of no conflict. You don't want that. There has to be conflict. It's the way humans exist. You are depressed when you have nothing going on. There's a reason why going to the gym is so therapeutic for so many people, because it's a conflict between you and yourself, right? It's a conflict. You have to push this weight or it will fall on your chest and break open your stupid bird chest. You know, you have to run. You have to do cardio or your heart will be unhealthy. You have to lose weight. There's so many things. You have to go to a job. You would much rather go to a job and make money than not working. If getting laid off, if not working was cool, you know, then everyone would be laid off and wouldn't be mad about it. Why are they upset? Because they like that conflict. They like to resolve issues, you know? And same thing, you just have so many people. It's going to be impossible to find that peace. So meanwhile, while peace is what we think we want, you have to respect and appreciate and love and remind those military people, those first responders, those police officers, and you can see it right behind me, right there. I am a very first responder pro person. I think because guess what? I'm only here because of cops. They raised me. You know, they raised me into the person that I am. And I could be a piece of shit to some, but I think I'm pretty awesome to a lot of people. And I think overall I'm a good person. I don't do things to hurt other people. At least I try not to. I tell people when they're a beautiful person. I tell people that they're smart. And I'm very honest with people. And I think we got to be really honest of what we actually want. And we got to be very honest and not lose fact that we are protected every day. And I can get up and I can go to the gym and I can study and I can work and I can make money without worrying about my house blowing up from a bomb because some terrorist group doesn't like me. That's serious shit. And I don't care if it's Veterans Day or if it's not Veterans Day when you guys hear this. And it won't be Veterans Day. But guess what? It is becoming close to the holidays and there's a lot of people that won't see their family. It's the time of the year, and I'm going to talk about it real quick, and I'm going to end up the podcast because I got to do a lot of homework, and we're about 50 minutes into it. This is the time of year. Clocks push back. It's getting colder outside, at least for where I live on the East Coast, maybe not in California, where I have a lot of listeners out in California. Thank you so much. I love California. I love Texas. You guys are amazing, beautiful people. And Utah, Salt Lake City. I got a lot of listeners out there too. But this is the time of year where it starts to get cold and family starts coming together. And guess what? There's families coming together, but there's also families that aren't coming together because people pass away, people die, people are struggling, people are getting sick right now. Just because the holidays are here doesn't mean that hospitals are empty. There's a time of the year where you have to, if you don't do it all year, you have to fix your issues with people. You have to resolve them. You cannot go into the holidays hating an individual. You liked them before you hated them. Figure that out. You know, there's people out there who are going to struggle this year. It's going to be cold. It's going to get dark outside very, very early. And that messes with a lot of people's head, especially if their life isn't going their way. This is the time of year where you put your arm out to strangers. You put your arm out to the person that you hate, that may be your sister, your brother, your mother, your grandpa, your uncle, whatever. And you dap them up and say, I love you. We may not agree on this, but I love you and I'm sorry for what I've done. And don't expect an apology. Just say you're sorry. So it's off your shoulders. It's off your shoulders. They can take it as they want. But this is the time of year that we have to support each other. We have to be there for each other because this is a hard time of the year for so many people out there. We all know people. We all know people that struggle at this time of year. We all know people, especially if you know someone that suffers with depression. This is the hardest time of year for them. You know, I think it's very important to keep those people in the back of your mind. Show the people that actually care, that actually protect you every day, that they matter. Hold people just a little bit closer. Drink your hot chocolate, drink your coffee. But I love you guys so much. Thank you so much for all the support that we get on these podcasts. This is episode 42. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Hopefully I didn't rant too much. But with that being said, guys, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to end this podcast like I've said before. I'll upload another one hopefully on Monday or Tuesday. But it's the time of the year, it's just that time of the year. You know, finals are coming up. Just got a lot of things. I got to go to court for like a business law project. So just a lot of things going on that I'm trying to get done. And then we will be back on a Monday, Tuesday, Friday upload. Probably just going to be Monday or Tuesday and Thursday every week. But thank you guys so much for listening. Have a great day. Please like, comment, subscribe if you're on YouTube. Share with the family and friends on all platforms. Leave a rating and a 5-star rating and a written rating on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. Guys, thank you so much and have a great week or weekend. Just have a great next hour of your life. Take it day by day, minute by minute. Thank you guys so much. See ya.